All right. Good afternoon. Welcome to today's webinar, Pop-Up Progress, Unveiling the Magic of Temporary Brownfield Makeovers, hosted in collaboration with NJIT Technical Assistance to Brownfield Communities, or NJIT TAB, and the Delaware Valley Regional Planning Commission. My name is Fatima Matos. I'm the events coordinator here at NJIT's Center for Community Systems. Myself and Mimi Marcus, our manager for marketing and engagement, will be helping to facilitate today's webinar. Before we get started, first want to go over some ground rules. One, this session will be recorded. All recordings and presentations shown today will be available on our website at www.njit.edu/tab. Two, if you have any questions, feel free to use the Q&A window to post them. To access this window, click the Q&A button on your toolbar. You may upvote them if you see a question that resonates with you or you'd also like answered. Questions will be read and answered at the end of the presentation. Three, don't have a question but have something to say? Feel free to use the chat window to express yourself. The chat button can also be found on your toolbar. We want to hear your thoughts as you listen to our panelists today. Is there something you're excited to learn about? Really vibing with the content and want to let everyone know? Feel free to let it all out. We want to hear from you. Get everyone into the groove and answer into the chat. What made you attend this webinar today? Mimi will be moderating our chat and posting some great links and resources relevant to today's discussion, so feel free to also check the chat as you listen to today's presentations. To review, type questions in the Q&A and comments in the chat window. Lastly, if you're having any technical issues during today's webinar, or if you know of any attendee that are having any trouble accessing the webinar, like they can't get in, feel free to email me at fm392@njit.edu. I'll be monitoring my email, will provide technical assistance as needed. Now, with those rules out of the way, we can begin. It is my pleasure to introduce a woman with over 16 years of experience in environmental investigation, assessment, and remediation, who is also an out-of-the-box creative thinker. She's also a New Jersey licensed site remediation professional and a New York licensed professional geologist. Our first speaker today is our Director of Environmental Services at NJIT's Center for Community Systems, Ms. Cailyn Bruno. With that, I'll turn it over to you, Cailyn.
Great, thanks, Fatima. Thanks for the intro. My contact information is on the screen now. I will also be presenting that at the very end. So let's pop off. Let's get into brownfields and pop-ups. We're going to be talking about abandoned and polluted properties and their creative reuse. But if there's one thing I want you to walk away from today is knowing that we don't have to wait for major redevelopment of these sites in order to address the negative impacts that they have on communities. And this is important because temporary reuse can lead to permanent, positive environmental, health, economic outcomes for the community. So let's start off with defining brownfields. If you're unfamiliar with the definition or the concept, the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency provides a definition for us. This is defined in the CERCLA law as a property, the expansion, redevelopment, or reuse of which may be complicated by the presence or potential presence of a hazardous substance, pollutant, or contaminant. So some brownfield sites are easy to identify. They can look like an abandoned factory, like the picture on the right, but some are just vacant tracts of land, like the picture on the left. And maybe based on information that we have about their former use, we might have reason to believe that chemicals were spilled or dumped there. Brownfields can be former factories, mills, warehouses, and rail yards that were abandoned when industry moved elsewhere, leaving behind residents without jobs, and as well as exposure to pollution. They can also be the closed gas station on the corner, the old auto repair shops, former dry cleaners, and other vacant commercial properties. These smaller businesses also use and store chemicals that could have the potential to spill and cause environmental problems. Buildings can also be brownfields just based on the nature of the materials themselves that they're constructed with. And here I'm talking about asbestos or lead paint. It's important to point out that not all brownfields are contaminated and not all contaminated sites are brownfields. An example of this is we might have an active gas station. It's still in business, but one of its underground storage tanks is leaking gasoline. Now, that's certainly an environmental problem, but it's not a brownfield because it's still in business. On the other hand, a site containing a closed auto repair facility is considered a brownfield. It might not necessarily be contaminated, but it's still contributing negatively to the surrounding community. Brownfields are present in almost every community, from urban to rural, residential, or industrial areas. And by their nature, they're canvases for change, stages for performance and gathering, and hold pretty much unlimited potential. Creative communities can take advantage of these distressed sites that no one else sees value in. Here's some examples of temporary or meanwhile use, such as an interactive community brainstorm project, festival grounds, an art installation, murals or public art, and even celebration of our industrial craft. Let's understand why it's important to focus on these distressed sites and the negative impact that brownfields have on communities. Brownfields can contribute to neighborhood deterioration and the negative perception of the neighborhood. They can attract vandals, open dumping, arson, or other illegal or unwanted activity. They can degrade the soil, water, and air quality of the neighborhood and potentially cause public health issues. They can also have economic impacts, such as lowering property values, reducing employment opportunities, lead to a loss of tax revenue, and limit economic growth. And bottom line is that these aren't just eyesores. They can have a real physical and psychological impact on the surrounding community. The human toll of vacant and derelict properties, of which brownfields are a subset, is something that's been studied. This slide summarizes conclusions of a study performed that relates the presence of vacant properties and public health. This study and others acknowledge that not all communities are impacted equally by this. And here I'm talking about how brownfields can indirectly inform the way a person feels about their ecosystem, their neighborhood, and their self-worth. Studies show that minorities, low-income residents, and those with limited English proficiency are exposed to more pollution than they're responsible for, on top of the other social burdens that they encounter. So this is really a foundational concept in the environmental justice movement and how brownfield development or redevelopment is related to equity. There's more at stake here. There's documented deaths, injuries, and also millions of dollars of tax revenue that could be diverted to other uses to service the community. But it's not all bad. There are some advantages of having brownfields in your community. Many are located along waterways and rail lines and in downtowns, giving them a locational advantage for temporary reuse and the eventual redevelopment. Many already have existing infrastructure, such as utility and sewer lines, and they can be historically or architecturally significant. Most of all, brownfield holds the potential for being transformed into a permanent community asset. That can be whatever the community needs. It could be affordable housing, factory jobs, retail, or maybe just a nice place to sit in the downtown district. Permanent reuse is the goal if it is feasible for these sites, but that's not the only option. Before we dive in much further, let's define temporary use. The temporary activation of vacant land or buildings with no foreseeable development demands, while the use of the site is, by agreement with the owner, time-limited and permitted until an investor emerges. There are some other terms for this. You might have come across these and maybe some others. For the sake of this presentation, we'll just think of these as all big one bucket of temporary reuse. There's nuances to all of these, but they have the same spirit of ephemerality. So now I want to pull back the veil for you on how we generally clean up sites for redevelopment. I want you to get some perspective on what we are ultimately trying to accomplish permanently for communities when we redevelop to community assets. And I think this will also give you context for how temporary use can help this process along. So this is a basic process. A local entity, it might be a city government, nonprofit, or a private developer will identify a brownfield that is suitable for redevelopment. They will assess the site, figure out where the contamination is, how bad it is, how deep it is, and then they'll clean it up before redeveloping the site. Now, of course, it's more complicated than that. For a successful brownfield redevelopment project, there are things that need to happen at the beginning and continue to happen all throughout to nurture this process, such as meaningful community engagement, building partnerships, finding funding sources, and perhaps you might need to revisit your site reuse vision. Pop-ups and temporary use can cultivate those activities, which are crucial to successful brownfield redevelopment projects. So there's an advantage right there. This process from planning to redevelopment takes time. It can be a lot of time. This is a question I get asked very often is, well, how long is it going to take me to redevelop this site? Of course, the answer depends. A really motivated private developer with unlimited resources might be able to get this done in less than a year. Other times, depending on factors such as resources, of course, but the extent of contamination, regulations, community input, it could take 5 years, 10 years, 20, a couple decades. So this is another reason why temporary use is beneficial. They can pop up at the site anywhere along this process, as long as we aren't exposing anyone to site contaminants. For this reason, you should at least have a phase one environmental site assessment. That's here, the second stage of the process, for your liability protection and to make sure we're not exposing anyone to pollution. I'm going to walk you through what that means in a couple of slides. But when we open up the possibility of meanwhile use, we can see that these vacant sites are opportunities for experimentation, to celebrate culture of an area, make neighborhoods safer, maybe make neighborhoods more resilient against climate change, and even market these sites to potential developers. We have opportunities related to the economy and marketing of a place, improving equity, like I mentioned, cultivating partnerships, and just being creative and having fun. I want you to step back and think of the bigger picture of site reuse and ultimately how these aspects not just benefit the community in the short term, but also act as important components to the ultimate goal of putting the site back into productive reuse permanently. So how do you know what the highest and best use is if you don't experiment a little? Or what happens when you get the neighbors together? What sort of creative ideas are generated? Do leaders emerge? Do you have entrepreneurs or project champions? Do you spark any interest in what the site can and should be? And do you, maybe you discovered that the site is in a climate vulnerable area. And if so, do you really want to invest in a permanent structure? I do want to point out that I'm not necessarily advocating that this is the best choice for every single brownfield out there, every neighborhood. Every brownfield is different. And of course, this isn't going to be a good fit in every situation. And I just want to point out some of the reasons why temporary use can become a beloved institution, especially in empowered marginalized communities. And it's not really a good look. It can cause some friction if you're removing something that the community has really embraced. So this could lead to bad press for the developer or maybe the local leadership. There can be valid concerns about gentrification, displacement, and worries that the community improvements won't directly benefit those that have lived with the brownfield and suffered the impacts. this can fuel real estate speculation, prospecting. They might be viewed as dispensable and hard to get commitments from local government if they don't see the value or just see it as a superficial improvement. And of course, we're dealing with contaminated properties. So there's an inherent hazard if you're inviting people to interact with an area that's polluted. You might have exposure to harmful materials, but those environmental concerns, as well as the other ones I mentioned, most of them can be mitigated with some planning. So I'm gonna go over now how we can mitigate the pollution exposure risk. And I'm gonna walk you through an example. This is a gas station on a main street in a downtown business district. It's very visible. It has been out of business since at least 2008. It's totally paved, it's painted black. So it contributes to flooding in the area, raises the land surface temperature as well. So it creates a heat island. So these are problems that we want to address. How do we go about finding out if this can be a safe place for a pop-up cafe? First, we'll want to do an assessment. And this consists of a phase 1 environmental site assessment. This is where you're going to hire a qualified environmental professional to take a deep dive into the history of the site, to see where pollution might occur at the site. And there's a bunch of resources that we have to perform this assessment. One of them is historic maps. So looking at this historic map, we'll look at that. We'll look at other reports, local databases, and we're going to compile a list of areas that we think might be contaminated from the prior use of chemicals, like maybe these gasoline tanks, for instance. This is a gas station, so there's going to be piping that used to be there, dispensers. We do a detailed site visit. So we might have observed floor drains in the building, thinking maybe chemicals were dumped down those. And maybe we see some stained soil on the site. If there's any possibility that an area could be contaminated, this should be identified and listed in the report. And then the next step is that we're going to go to all those places that we suspect might be contaminated and do a phase 2 environmental site assessment. We're going to go out, sample, and confirm if there is pollution present. So we'll drill holes, take soil samples. Those are the little pink boxes here. Our goal when we're doing this investigation and assessment is trying to draw a picture of what's really happening underground. This is removing the mystery of what's happening in 3 dimensions so we can move forward with some degree of confidence about what our possible exposure points are and how we can protect people. So once we have that, we can move forward with our site vision. In this example, we've removed the stained soil pile, and during our investigation, we confirmed that actually this pavement is in pretty good condition. And it acts as an effective cap. It's thick enough. There's no cracks. So that's going to prevent people from coming into contact with the contaminated soil below. We're not drinking the water here. This site is hooked up to city water. So if there is groundwater contamination, we're not exposing anyone to that. We might have concerns about the vapors that are coming off of the contaminated soil and groundwater. These are usually a concern too. If you have a building, they might accumulate within a building atmosphere, but for our intended use, no one's going in there. The people that will be on site will just be there for maybe a couple hours a day, and they're in the open air. So we're not going to be concerned here about exceeding that permissible exposure. We can beautify the property, lighten it up with some art to address the heat island impact and make it more bright and cheery. We're going to install some flowers and greenery to improve the air quality, make a nice little gathering place, and showcase a small business and give Polly Walnuts here a place to grab a coffee before he hops on the Garden State Parkway. Okay, you might be thinking, Yeah, that sounds nice. This also sounds very expensive. How are we going to pay for this? There are resources, especially for local governments, institutions, and nonprofits. The first one I want to mention today is the EPA Brownfields program. Because of the bipartisan infrastructure law, they have a ton of money right now. It's not going to last forever. So this is something you should really be thinking of applying for if this interests you even a little bit. These tend to be high dollar amounts, so they're really looking for more of like a city or regional scale projects. So if you have a couple of brownfields in mind, it's going to be a really good option for you. The EPA also has funding for targeted brownfield assessment grants. So this is just like on the site scale, they can do that those assessments for you. Your state brownfield program might have funding available, and you'd also want to check with your regional planning entity. And speaking of that, I'd like to kick it over now to Spencer Gober. He's a certified planner and associate manager at the Office of Community and Economic Development at the Delaware Valley Regional Planning Commission.
Thanks, Cailyn and NJIT for inviting me to speak today. And good afternoon again, everyone. I'll share my screen really quickly. And hopefully everyone can see that. So as Cailyn said, I am with the Delaware Valley Regional Planning Commission, or DVRPC. I'm the associate manager in the Office of Community and Economic Development here. And I'm going to take a few minutes to talk about the benefits and considerations of pop-ups, but also how to turn these short-term strategies into longer-term investment, building off some of the things that Cailyn just talked about. Before I dive into the work itself, I want to give a brief overview of who DVRPC is for anyone who may not be familiar. Created in 1965, DVRPC is the federally mandated NPO for the 9-county Greater Philadelphia area, of which 4 counties are in New Jersey: Burlington, Camden, Gloucester, and Mercer. In addition to conducting short, medium, and long-term plans, DVRPC also provides funding for projects around transportation, land use, economic development, equity, open space, housing, and more. So with that, let's go ahead and start talking about pop-ups. Much of what I'm going to go over today is also contained in greater detail in DVRPC's publication titled The Pop-Up Economy, which is publication number 26 in our Municipal Implementation Tools series. You can find a digital copy of the report on DVRPC's website, and I think we actually are going to drop a link into the chat today as well. The report was actually published in 2015, but I think the fact that we are still talking about pop-ups as relevant planning strategies nearly 10 years later is a testament to their value and effectiveness. The reason that pop-ups are so popular for both the public and private sectors is that their temporary nature makes them low-cost and low-risk efforts, but they're also fun and engaging. The low-cost nature allows for greater experimentation, so if the project ends up not working out or being not as successful as one had hoped, there's no problem really, because you've had very little exposure to risk in the first place, and you can always take those lessons learned and try them again. And in fact, here at DVRPC, we have an entire program dedicated to funding and implementing pop-up infrastructure and placemaking projects in partnership with local municipalities. Our experimental pop-ups, or expo program, uses things like traffic cones, hay bales, and temporary paint to test complete streets projects, bike lanes concepts, and more. And this allows residents the opportunity to interact with and provide feedback on these types of infrastructure changes before they've been made permanent and before any longer term investment is made. There's no correct way to pop up either. They can range from food trucks to parking day installations and from farmers markets to beer gardens. One of my favorite pop-ups in Philly is Parks on Tap, which is a program hosted by the Parks and Recreation Department. Every summer they announce dates and a list of select park locations throughout the city where their beer gardens are going to pop up for a short period of time. And it's nice when they pop up in your neighborhood because all of a sudden you have this great amenity, but then it's also a fantastic reason to get out into the city and visit a part of the city that you might not typically go to. And that's a point I want to keep in mind for later on in my presentation. This past year, they actually had a new aspect to Parks on Tap, where they had a program where if you purchased one of their branded cups, you could get a discount on every refill throughout the entire summer, as long as you brought the cup back with you. So not only was this a way to cut down on waste and increase sustainability at the beer gardens themselves, but it also made for a great branding and marketing opportunity. But we're here to talk about brownfield pop-ups specifically. And I think the temporary and low-cost nature of pop-ups make them a fantastic strategy for activating brownfields, as well as showing their potential and the potential for the surrounding community as a whole. But the very nature of pop-ups is that they're fleeting and short-term, and so it's kind of unrealistic to expect that one pop-up event is going to transform a brownfield permanently or immediately attract the type of outside investment that you might be hoping for. So in most cases, a series of pop-ups in and around the brownfield may be necessary, and beyond that, taking more concrete and midterm steps to help cultivate the type of redevelopment and investment you're looking to see on the site. This gets to the point that Cailyn was making about the time needed to realize your goals for a brownfield. It could take decades, but that doesn't mean that in the meantime that you can't utilize the site and lay the groundwork for redevelopment. And you have to kind of really think about pop-ups as seeds that you're planting. And then if you don't water those seeds and care for those seeds, they're not going to grow into the type of development that you want to see. So in addition to highlighting our work on pop-ups, I also want to talk about one of our recent publications titled Cultivating a Homegrown Economy. This report talks about the types of midterm strategies needed to take the seeds you've planted with pop-ups and foster long-term community and economic development. And between the two reports, there are common themes worth highlighting and keeping in mind as you consider implementing pop-ups in your community or taking more concrete steps like those discussed in the Homegrown Economy report. For instance, I mentioned that there's no right or wrong way to pop up. They can really be anything that you want, but they really should be unique to your community and highlight the local assets in your community. Focus on the things that make where you live or even the brownfield site specifically special. Maybe it's the architecture there or the history, and then leverage those qualities. Similarly, placemaking is a huge component of any pop-up and should be part of any longer-term strategies as well. And the great thing about pop-ups and homegrown economies is that they are often grassroots in nature and successful because of the high level of community engagement and excitement that surrounds them. Ask yourself, who are the anchor institutions or big employers in your community? They have a stake in the success of your efforts and can benefit from branding and marketing related to your pop-ups. So if you can, partner with them and get them to sponsor if possible. Lastly, does your current permitting process allow for pop-up shops, food trucks, and beer gardens? If not, or if you're not sure, you should review and revise as necessary to help foster a culture of pop-ups within your community. If there's this pop-up ecosystem exists, it makes it a little bit easier for your specific pop-up on your brownfield site to be more successful. And as you start to think about longer term, does your zoning allow for the type of permanent investment that you're looking to attract? So if you had a beer garden that you popped up and it was successful and you've proven that there's a market for craft beers in your community, but your zoning doesn't allow for breweries or tap rooms, then you're never going to really see the type of development occur in your community, even if there's a market for it. So on that note, in the Homegrown Economy report, I lay out a series of strategies that range from economic, environmental, and socially sustainable strategies, but I want to focus on one particular for my first case study, and that's to enable the craft beverage industry. The Reading Viaduct is an elevated rail line in Center City, Philadelphia, originally built in the 1890s to carry commuters. It cuts through a neighborhood that today is known as the Loft District or Eraserhood or Callow Hill, depending on who you ask. And the viaduct was abandoned in 1984 and left to become overgrown with weeds. This image shows what it looked like in 2017. Similarly, a decade ago, the surrounding neighborhood was blighted and full of vacancy. It is still one that is in transition today, but private sector investment is obvious throughout the neighborhood now. And this image shows almost the exact same angle as Reading Viaduct looked on the day that it opened and was christened as the Rail Park back in 2018. And again, another image from 2017 and the same angle as it looks today. But we're here to talk about pop-ups, and it seems like I've jumped a little bit ahead to the final chapter in the story of the Reading Viaduct. So I want to take a step back to 2016 when the Pennsylvania Horticultural Society, or more commonly known as PHS, hosted a pop-up beer garden underneath the abandoned Reading Viaduct. And the beer garden itself was actually branded the Viaduct. In 2016, this was not an area of the city where you would typically find crowds of people getting together for happy hour after work, but the PHS Beer Garden activated this space and showed what could be viable in that neighborhood. You can see from this picture that the beer garden was literally under the viaduct, and PHS simply used shipping containers and outdoor furniture to create the space. But I even want to step further back because remember I said that pop-ups and even cultivating a homegrown economy should be unique and authentic to the community and should leverage local culture and identity. By the time PHS popped up under the viaduct, they had already perfected the pop-up concept. Their first pop-up was in 2011 at 20th and Market Streets, which is in the heart of Philly's financial district. And it's a much less risky location than the viaduct location. One reason that the viaduct pop-up was successful was because there was already a culture of pop-up beer gardens in the city, and PHS had brand recognition and a proven concept. Since the pop-up, three craft breweries have opened within five blocks of the original pop-up location, and one of them even opened up across the street from the original location. And I'm not trying to suggest that there's a cause and effect here, but I do want to highlight in this case study that it's important to choose a pop-up concept that is consistent with your community and the culture there. In Philly, there is a craft beer and beer garden culture, and that culture made the Viaduct Beer Garden a success and activated the Reading Viaduct space before its conversion to the rail park. To go from a pop-up beer garden to a craft beverage economy, though, you have to have the right type of zoning in place. Not all craft breweries are alike, and some require more space than others. So take a look at the type of buildings that are located in your brownfield. Could they be the future home of a brewery? And if so, amend your zoning accordingly, or could the vacant site itself accommodate construction of the new brewery? I also want to take a minute to highlight a pop-up that's outside of Philly, and it doesn't involve beer. It's if you're not familiar with Phoenixville, Pennsylvania, it's a former still town that went into decline in the 1980s and 90s, but has enjoyed a renaissance over the past two decades and has been the recipient of significant private sector investment and redevelopment in recent years. The vacant site that you see on the screen was the location of the first ever Phoenixville Firebird Festival, which began in 2004 in a sort of ad hoc way by several residents active in the local artist community as a way in which to bring the community together and celebrate the rebirth of Phoenixville with the rising of the Phoenix or the Firebird. In its first year, there were 150 people who attended the festival. After 2 years on the original site, the festival had to relocate in 2006 due to development pressures, but would continue to be held annually at different locations around town due to shifting development pressures in Phoenixville. The original site was finally redeveloped in 2015, and by 2023, the festival was attracting more than 20,000 attendees. And I think this gets to one of the points that Cailyn made. One of the hazards of doing a pop-up is that it could be so successful that it becomes a permanent fixture in your community. And if it is faced with redevelopment pressure, which is the ultimate goal, you'll need to anticipate how to find a new home for it and a way to keep it in the community. And I like this example because it shows that something like an ad hoc pop-up festival can actually become an important fixture and a part of a local identity. So much so that the building that was built on the original festival location has a giant Firebird mural painted on its side, again, reinforcing the idea that local identity and the unique characteristics of a community are important to save and highlight and even leverage as part of any pop-up or longer-term economic development strategies. Which brings us back to the common themes that should be taken into consideration as you plan your pop-ups and begin to think about how to use those pop-ups as catalysts for longer-term investment and redevelopment. Before I wrap things up, I do want to briefly highlight DVRPC's Transportation and Community Development Initiative, or TCDI grant program. We alternate funding rounds annually between the Pennsylvania and New Jersey side of our region, and our next New Jersey round will be held in January of 2025, so this time next year. This program is a great way to fund market feasibility studies and redevelopment plans for brownfield sites for anyone who is within our four New Jersey counties looking to do this type of work. I encourage you to take a look at this grant program and become familiar with it. So with that, I'll wrap up my presentation with my contact information. Please feel free to reach out to me if you have any questions in the future or want to keep this conversation going. I'm happy to answer anything over email or talk over the phone. So with that, Cailyn, I will hand it back to you.
Great, thank you. So I have two more case studies for you to show you some real projects and how they were able to be implemented. This one is from Flemington, New Jersey. The entire town is an opportunity zone in an environmental justice area. They had an abandoned gas station on Main Street. Sounds familiar, right? The town had foreclosed on this due to unpaid taxes. And actually, this site, years earlier, the state environmental agency had performed some cleanup there, and it had racked up an environmental lien worth over $1.6 million, putting this site just completely underwater. This property wasn't worth nearly that much, and there was still more environmental work to be done. So they were having a hard time getting bites here. The town and the state came up with an agreement that the environmental lien will be dropped if the town will fork over the proceeds from the eventual resale of the property. So this is worth it to the town to get this site back into productive reuse. However, as you can imagine, no one was biting at this opportunity again. So the town had to get creative. So what they did was they beautified this site with some flower boxes, fresh coat of paint, and transformed it into a weekend seasonal beer garden. Very popular pop-up, but everyone loves it. It became a very successful event, a destination for people from the surrounding towns, and it really did showcase how popular this location could be if it really reached its full potential. And a local restaurateur and developer did take notice, saw how positive the surrounding revitalization as well in the downtown area was making it a popular place. So it's currently undergoing some additional cleanup, and it will be transformed into a brunchonette. Another example, an old gas station on a main street. This comes from Chicopee, Massachusetts. This is an environmental justice community outside the city of Springfield. The city has enacted some policies that have been really supportive of new businesses, new restaurants, young chefs, and the downtown has been experiencing some revitalization, but this empty lot persisted. Among a couple others, it's an abandoned gas station and an auto body repair shop, which had not been in business since at least 2007. The prior owner had actually already initiated some environmental cleanup activities before abandoning the site, so it was already on the regulator's radar. The city acquired the property through tax foreclosure and then transformed it into a food truck park. They have vendor booths for small businesses and a stage for DJs or performers, of course, picnic tables. So how are they able to do this? This site was identified as one of several infill sites as part of the city's West End Brownfields area-wide plan. They had gotten a grant from an EPA pilot program to create that plan, which highlighted other larger priority brownfield sites around the city. So it suggested in the plan that short-term improvements be made to some of these smaller infill sites as a strategy for getting these smaller sites assessed, clean them up, and just improve the aesthetics and the marketability of the area as a whole, and to showcase the general commitment that the city has to redevelopment and revitalization. So I mentioned the pilot program grant that they received. That was in 2012. They did have a targeted brownfield assessment grant for this site in particular. They also got that in 2012. They were able to do some cleanup activities. They got a grant in 2015, some state level funding, and also they had some volunteer in-kind contribution. And I think this is really important to point out too. Some of these improvements that we're talking about can be done by a city DPW, for instance. You don't necessarily have to do something super sophisticated or expensive. But, you know, that being said, realistically, they had the pilot program and the planning stages. They initiated that in 2012, and it finally, I guess, broke ground in 2021. So keeping that time frame in mind is important. So now I want to tell you about NJIT TAB, our program, and then we'll open it up for questions. If this process and if brownfields in general seems overwhelming and that there's a lot here, that's because it kind of is, but there is help out there for you. We have the TAB program, which is Technical Assistance to Brownfields Communities. We are funded by the EPA. However, we're an independent resource. And through the money that we get from the EPA, we're able to provide free assistance to state, territory, regional, county, tribal, and local government entities, nonprofits, and we really help you throughout the whole process, whether you're just in the planning stages, you're ready to hire a contractor, you're at the cleanup phase, or you're ready to market your site. We've been doing this for a long time. And we provide this service for free to EPA regions 2 and 4. We provide assistance 3 main ways. We have our Brownfields Academy, we have the Brownfield Community Engagement and Educational Forums, and one-on-one technical assistance. Our Brownfield Academy is our website. This is where we have a lot of tools. It's updated very often. So this webinar is being recorded. We're going to put that on our website as well as all the slides. So this information will be available to you. We also have infographics, news, success stories. So it's a good resource to check it out. Get on our mailing list as well there. We do educational forums such as this one. We're also out there just, you know, educating people, spreading the gospel of brownfields and what they can be transformed into. We do this through workshops, conferences, a whole bunch of options that we have that we can come visit you, your community, and do some education. Our real bread and butter, though, is our one-on-one technical assistance. Again, this is free for local governments, nonprofits. There is no application process for this. You just reach out to me directly or any of the contacts on our website. This is really necessary because every brownfield site is different. Every community is different. There is no cookie cutter solution for any of these challenges that we're talking about. So we can help walk you through all of those. And that's my spiel. That's my little commercial for our TAB program here. I've summarized some of the links that we presented and have been dropped in the chat. And here is our contact information. So feel free to put any questions in the Q&A box. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Cailyn and Spencer, for that. A lot of really great, amazing information. We do have one question. How can you connect with local artists, artisans, craft makers who can bring their art to your space?
So I guess if there's not a visible, you know, established community of artisans in your community already through, if you don't have, you know, like a maker space, a dedicated maker space or an art gallery, it may take a bit of sleuthing. You could reach out to the art teachers in your local schools. They may be connected to the artist community in a way on the side, on the weekends. And additionally, you could check out Etsy. That's one place that you can go and find out who are the makers that are active in your community that are already actively selling things online. it's a great way to actually take them from, you know, the e-commerce world and leverage them in your community. Doing some type of maker pop-up is a fantastic example of a pop-up. And, you know, I like this question specifically because one of the other really great homegrown economy strategies that I like to talk about is small scale manufacturing. And it really is, it's enabling these makers who are existing sort of in the shadows and providing them the type of permitting and zoning, allowing them to create a brick and mortar establishment and formalize their craft and begin to scale it up in a way that is not, you know, full blown industrial manufacturing, but it's still, you know, craft small scale manufacturing that can exist on Main Street or in even on Brownfields locations.
Great. We have another question. What ways are there to approach property owners' concerns about liability of allowing the public onto their sites?
You know, it really is about partnerships and actually kind of is related to the first question. This is where you really need to be intentional about your partnerships. Not every private property owner is going to be amenable to this. And that's just the reality. And of course, you know, it's their property and it's their liability. However, you know, doing a phase one environmental site assessment, knowing where your hazards are and how to mitigate that and working with your qualified environmental professional, I think is the best way. And to approach it as a partnership. What is my answer?
Cool. Okay. In general, are communities more supportive of temporary pop-ups on brownfield sites than complete redevelopment of their sites?
Cailyn, you may have more to add on to this, but I think my answer actually builds off of what you just said. And I think it really depends on how much public engagement have you, done. Success really depends on community and public buy-in and participation, both in the pop-up and in growing your economy locally. And so I think the first thing to do if you want to do a pop-up is engage the public, engage the surrounding community and let them know what your ideas are, get their input. That way you can ensure that whatever you end up doing, they're in support of, whether it be, you know, a short-term pop-up or your long-term plans for the site.
Great. I think that's all the questions we have so far. I don't know if you want to give a few moments for people to catch up, but I think that's all the questions for today.
Okay, great. Yeah, I just want to add, you know, to what Spencer said about community engagement. You know, that could be a whole webinar in and of itself, because that is such a really important part of any sort of brownfield activity as well, whether it is a pop-up or you're, you know, engaging the community in what the eventual site vision is permanently for that that project. But really successful brownfield redevelopment projects are going to address a community need.
Great. I think with that said, I think we are good for today. Feel free again to reach out and check out the NJIT TAB website, as well as the Delaware Valley Regional Planning Commission website. If you have any more questions, I know in the chat we put a lot of useful links and information, as well as Cailyn's contact information and Spencer's contact information. We thank you today for joining us, and we hope to see you again soon for any of our future webinars.
Thanks, everybody.
Thanks, everybody. Thank you.